够人了，我们就
Members, it's the appointed time and we have a quorum. Let me call the meeting to order. First item on the agenda, minutes of the policy briefing committee on 24th of January 2017 has been forwarded to members and we have not received any proposals for amendments. Can we please confirm the minutes? Thank you. Information papers issued since the last meeting. The Secretariat has not issued any information papers. Let's go to the next item for discussion, and that is item 3. We have electrical paper, CB bracket 1699, bracket 01, and bracket 02. One is a list of outstanding items, and the other one is a list of follow-up actions. The next meeting will be held on the 25th of April at Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. The administration has proposed 4 items. 1 Tong Chung New Town Extension, Reclamation and Advance Works. 2 Improvement to Hoiban Road Park and adjacent area. 3 Proposed creation of a permanent post of Chief Landscape Architect in ASD. And 4th Implementation Arrangements for the Hong Shui Kiu New Development Area Project. Members, do you have any questions about these 4 items? Mr. Roy Kwong. Thank you, Chair. On the 25th of March at Langham Place, there is this escalator accident. I'd like to know whether we can hold a special meeting under this panel. This morning, the President did not give permission for me to ask an urgent question. Well, we are talking about next month, next month's regular meeting. We are not talking about having a special meeting or not. But there are 2 possibilities. One, we can include it in the agenda, or you can consider holding a special meeting. Just now, you did not say you want to include this in the agenda for the next meeting. You only said you wanted a special meeting. I heard you very clearly, and that is why I'm telling you we are discussing the regular meeting next month. But could I propose it now? Which incident? I could not hear you just now. Chairman, I'm talking about a very controversial accident in Langham Place, which is also attracting a lot of concern. I'd like to include it in the agenda for the next meeting, or the chairman can decide to hold a special meeting. Are you clear? Now I'm clear, because I did not hear you say Langham Place. You must remember, at my age, I'm a bit deaf. You can speak into the mic and speak slowly, but I have confidence in you, Chairman. The administration has proposed these 4 items. I believe we need at least 3 hours for them. We have a backlog of items to handle. If members have no objection, I think we'll adopt these 4 items, and I will also extend the next meeting to 5:30, all right? And now we can continue to discuss Mr. Roy Kwong's proposal to hold a special meeting on the escalator incident at Langham Place. Members, any views? Mr. Lam Chuk Ting. Mr. Chairman, since you propose to adopt those 4 items for the next meeting, and the escalator incident is also a matter of urgency because the public are very concerned, I agree that we should hold a special meeting to discuss it. Who raised his hand just now? Ms. Tanya Chan. Chairman, I'd like to ask whether the escalator incident should be discussed by this panel. And if there is going to be a discussion, I will welcome it. And one of the papers should be such that, because the administration is saying that any escalator that is over 15 meters long should be subject to examination right away. I'd like to have a checklist of where these escalators are. Are they in private places or at MTR stations? And if an examination is done, we'd like to have a report. Certainly, some background information should be included as well. Just now, you asked whether it should be discussed by this panel. Well, certainly, this is a matter for the EMSD, so it is related to this panel. At least, this is what I think. Mr. Ben Chan.
Thank you, Chairman.
There has been a spate of escalator incidents, the one at Lam Tin Station just last night, and so Langham Place, Lam Tin Station, and this might be related to one escalator engineering company, the same company. So the issue is serious. Chairman, if possible, let us make arrangements. I understand the relevant departments have to attend that meeting, so please try to arrange that meeting. Okay, if there is no objection, let us not waste time since we have a tight agenda. I also think that it is okay to arrange a special meeting. I will talk to the departments and members. I am sure the clerk will write down notes. I don't know whether you want to hang more things onto the Christmas tree. Maybe it would be better for you to write a short note to the clerk so that we know exactly what will be discussed and so officials can get prepared. It is not easy to find time next month, but we'll try our very best. All right? Let us come back to our agenda. Item 4. PWP item number 751CL, Planning and Engineering Study on Sunny Bay Reclamation. This was started on the 28th of February because we did not have enough time to finish the item. There are two papers, one CB bracket 1 578 bracket 07 and another one bracket 08. And also CB bracket 1699 bracket 03, a letter dated 28th of February from Honorable Stephen Ho. Mr. Michael Tin and Mr. Jeremy Tam have both submitted motions, and those are in 699 bracket 04 and also bracket 05. This one is from Jeremy Tam, the last one from Michael Tin. The administration team is here. They are very efficient. I'd like to ask whether members or the administration would like to speak first. No need? Okay. I will now read out the names that I have jotted down last time because you did not have time to ask questions last time. Ben Chen, Leung Kwok Hong, Edward Yu, Nathan Law, Tanya Chen, Jeremy Tam, Kwok Wai Kang, Lo Wai Kwok, Alice Mack, Edward Lau, Stephen Ho, Michael Look.
For this item, actually by 3:05, I'd like to finish it. Well, according to the agenda, it's supposed to be wrapped up 3:05. And we've got two motions, one by Jeremy Tam and the other by Tin Pak Shen. So the two motions are different. For Michael Tian's motion, it should come first because it supports Sunny Bay, because if that motion is passed, then Jeremy Tam's motion for rejecting the funding proposal would not be voted on. But of course, if Michael Tam's motion is defeated, then we will vote on Jeremy Tam's. Yes? Chairman, I disagree with you. Because we have different reasons, and this is not a big sitting. We're not to amend the motions. And also, I've also moved one motion only, so I don't see. But let me tell you, please don't argue over this. This is not, it is a non-binding motion. Anyway, you want to stop the study and the other motions ask for the study. So if the, so they are exclusive, mutually exclusive. So if you put in your motion first and if your motion is passed, I wouldn't let his motion be voted on anyway. You need to understand what I'm saying. What rules of procedures give you that decision? In our call for chairman, section 3.58 for this panel. When there are any conflicting motions, if the first motion is passed, then the other motion will be rejected. So it's because of the order the two motions were submitted. So if your motion came first, and if your motion is passed later on, I wouldn't let Michael Tian's motion be voted on anyway, still. So it's about the order, and because yours are conflicting motions. Well, Mr. Tam, I'm not going to talk about the reasons for the differences in the motions anyway. Having looked at both motions, my view is that they are conflicting. So if one is passed, we would not vote on the other. If one is not passed, then we'll vote on the other. I don't want to dwell on this anymore. We don't have time. Okay, Ben Chen. Thank you, Chairman. On this Sunny Bay Reclamation Planning and Engineering Study, I support it. Sorry, 3 minutes. I think we have talked a lot about the problems, and because this piece actually is not to be for a residential purpose because of a noise concern, and because it's near an MTR station and near Disneyland tourism sport, therefore the site itself for the overall economic development of Lantau, even entertainment tourism there, has huge potential value. And also, the Hong Kong-Macau Zhuhai Bridge is going to be commissioned, and we need to have new projects near it. Therefore, I would support the department carrying out the study for the reclamation to carry out environmental impact assessment and also detailed investigation as well, site investigation. But we do hope that during the process, the departments should pay more attention. I know that Michael Tian has moved. Michael Tian is in. Well, we do support Michael Tian's motion. Earlier on, we wanted to move a motion as well, but now that Michael Tian has incorporated the AB's proposals, including in the fishing area, an impact study be conducted, and so forth, and also for various items of developments, residents in Ma Wan should also be taken into account. Therefore, all these ideas having been incorporated into Michael Tian's motion, we would support his motion, therefore. So we would not move any motion now on our part. So as for this study, I'd like to ask the department, on your study, how long would it take? And if there is to be some investigation, would you look into the rock, layers of rock underground, so as to avoid any future problems? Who would answer? Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Lau? I think this study will take 2 years. And there will be some investigation works included. Because of the need for reclamation, the investigation will be more detailed. So we hope that by the time reclamation takes place, we can have a good grasp of the situation on the ground. And also, during the process of site investigation, I hope that you can do a more thorough job. Mr. Michael Tian supports allocating a space for car parks. We do hope that you will consider also using the space for commercial and trade purposes. Next one is Lan Guohong. Yu Chung Yim, next. Thank you, Chairman. I said earlier and did make contact with government departments. Let me declare my interest early on. CEDD, when I was at Chinese University, commissioned our institute on to carry out a reclamation study in another area using a new technique for the design. Therefore, we want to propose that maybe the CEDD can consider using the same kind of technology instead of assuming that reclamation is a must and also assuming the use of the area following reclamation. On the other hand, we would like them to consider you know, academically speaking, use the SURET method, give the stakeholders a chance to be adequately engaged to talk about the design and use and the scale of reclamation at the site, rather than just making presumptions at this stage. So can the government consider that? Mr. Lau? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Yu, for your proposal. I think our planning and engineering study proposal will involve actually a public engagement exercise to collect stakeholders' views on how the site should be used. And it will be our first time, as Mr. Yu said, to adopt such an approach. And we have already collected some public opinions already. So there are merits in this approach. But as I said, because you used it for the first time, later on we'll need to review its effectiveness and see whether there are areas where we can make improvements. For the Sunny Bay Reclamation Public Engagement Exercise, we'll make reference to previous experience to decide on the mode of public engagement. Next one, Nathan Law. Thank you, Chairman. Justin Yu Chun Yim asked a similar question, and a follow-up here. I believe that your study being done now is one in on how to reclaim and also what to be make use of the site. It seems like whether the community's opinions can be reflected in your study is something questionable, because you've sort of given the impression that you must go for reclamation, and then people are trying to put all sorts of wishes on the tree, on the wish tree. So the government, would you have a study without any preconceived stance, so that environmental groups can really seriously study whether the land there should have reclamation at all? Mr. Lai? I think for reclamation in Sunny Bay and this proposal itself, as I said at the last meeting, you know, it was an idea raised long time ago. It's part of the Lantau conceptual development plan, and also in our strategy to increase land supply, we had already conducted two rounds of public consultation. Early last year, for the Lantau development plan, we mentioned the proposed reclamation in Sunny Bay to provide recreational facilities and tourism facilities. So during the past consultations, we had received a lot of public views, and on the whole, they were in favor of the reclamation idea so as to provide more land for development of recreational facilities. Yes. Well, I do have much doubts about what you said, whether the public really favor reclamation. I believe that many members would continue to follow up on this and try to let the public have a say. I hope that you can really open up a chance for more widespread public engagement. Personally, I receive different views on the reclamation proposal. There's a huge question mark now over it. And just as the government said, there are a lot of development projects being discussed in Kai Tak, West Kowloon, and also Northwest Lantau. You know, there are lots of cultural recreational plans being discussed. In carrying out each project, the government will say that Hong Kong lacked tourism spots, so you need to give a boost to the sector. But have you done any estimates looking into all the projects? When added together, will they be providing more than enough facilities, similar facilities? So has the government on tourism, sports, has the government ever done a demand study? You know how big the demand is. Okay, Tanya Chen, I think Nathan Law asked a good question. My understanding is that tourism may not actually attract that many tourists as you hoped for. If you just rely on man-made sea sightseeing spots to attract tourists, then you know the same spots could be replicated elsewhere. I think on the contrary, we need to value our nature, because that gives us the distinct characteristics. And secondly, I don't know whether You know, this is just coincidence. The transport panel just discussed the building route 11. The head of the bridge is near the reclamation site. Route 11 would connect the East Lantern Metropolis. This is the picture of the Route 11. And the government likes to use words like synergy effects to promote infrastructure projects. So Route 11, will it create any synergy effect with the East Lantern Metropolis plan? Or will you carry out some study? And will reclamation be actually an excuse here? Or do you want to really build the East Lantern Metropolis as the ultimate goal? I think Sunny Bay Reclamation and Route 11 are separate projects. And the entrance to the route would not be near the reclamation site. But is it near? Is it around the reclamation site? Yes, it is around the reclamation site. As for the under 2030 plus and the consultation there in the strategic transport infrastructure study, if the East Lantern Metropolis as a long-term development area for Hong Kong, our proposal is that there should be a transport system serving that area. So in the long run, if there's social support for the idea, then the Route 11 can be connected with East Lantern Metropolis, even Hong Kong Island and New Territories Northwest, so as to have a more comprehensive transportation network. So my other question is, in your paper, you said that in Sunny Bay, there are very few white Chinese dolphins. Well, I think we've seen from news that the number of such dolphins has dwindled a lot. But is it really a place where Chinese white dolphins used to be active in? You are expecting the third runway as well to be commissioned soon. So is there any way for the Chinese white dolphins to move around? Mr. Lau, understand that reclamation to marine ecology, you know, it will have some effect, and I know there's concern about the fate of Chinese white dolphins. Therefore, a few years ago, we carried an on-site survey of the Chinese white dolphins. At the last meeting, we said that the survey showed that, sorry, we've overrun. Is there any way for the dolphins to move around? We have seen that in recent years, the Chinese white dolphins to the southwest of Lantau have been seen. So that means there's a way for them to, the area for them to move around. Okay, next one. This funding, the problem with it is you have not confirmed what you want to do at the site. You have listed a whole range of options. But you have a bit of planning. You're applying now for funding for the planning study. But the problem is, you don't have any specific project in mind.
You're talking about 60 to 100 hectares, which is a big area. You say there will be hotels, and that would only require a few hectares. You don't have a comprehensive plan as to what you want to do there. So I will not support this funding request. Because reclamation will be allowed in that area, so you just go for it without any concrete plan in mind. I won't support such an approach. There are many constraints here in terms of height, noise, and you can't say I will be building residential houses there. Well, that I can understand, but then no residential buildings can be erected here because there are height constraints. And you are just creating land with a lot of money, and I don't know whether that is in line with economic principles. Has the Bureau asked the Tourism Board what tourist attractions will be set here? Have you consulted the Hong Kong TB? Mr. Lai? In general, whether we need more land to build tourist attractions. In terms of the blueprint of Lantau development, we have liaised with the Tourism Commissioner and the Hong Kong TB. To answer Mr. Tam, it is not that we are reclaiming land for the sake of reclamation. We have decided on the main use, and that is recreational leisure and entertainment. That is the main purpose. But what are we going to put there? We will do so according to the planning and engineering study. Mr. Tam and other people, like Mr. Michael Tian, he is proposing a racetrack. We will do that through the study. Well, if you are telling me that there will be a racetrack, at least maybe you need 60 to 80 hectares, then at least I know there is one item that would convince me that you need the land. Whether you are doing reclamation or not, I don't know. At least you have to tell me what item or what cluster of items you expect to build there. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, not here. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, not here. Miss Alice Mack, she's here. I'm still here, Chairman. This is for planning and engineering studies. I think this has been asked by many members. Recently, after projects are done, we were told that you did not do enough ground investigation during the investigation stage. I'd like to ask how you can ensure that we can rely you to do good investigation beforehand this time around. I think many members also asked this question. I have a lot of feelings towards Sunny Bay because I used to pass by that area when I did my first job. The bay there is tranquil, so tranquil it cannot be repeated easily anywhere in Hong Kong. Now, if after reclamation, how can you make sure that the land will be used in or for purposes that will be in line with the atmosphere in Lantau? Somebody proposed a racetrack, but should we also use the land for R&D so we can create jobs? Will you think about future uses on this piece of land in terms of other uses in Lantau? Would it be that after reclamation you would tell me actually you did not need the reclamation? Mr. Lai, about the main sites in North Lantau, we have thought about their market positioning and also their economic benefit. Perhaps I can ask the Assistant Director of Planning, Ms. Amy Jung, to comment. Thank you, Chair. In early this year, the Planning Department finished the initial development study on Lantau and also market positioning of Lantau. We have looked at a few developments in North Lantau, including extension of Tung Chung New Town, Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, development on the superstructure, Siu Ho Wan reclamation, and also Sunny Bay reclamation. These are the main sites, and we studied how they will be positioned. It has been confirmed that the major direction of developing Sunny Bay reclamation into a place for recreation, leisure, and entertainment. And also, there will be new developments at the bridge. There will be more opportunities for us to develop diversified tourist attractions and high-quality hotels. Next one, Stephen Ho, 3 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Fishermen do not welcome reclamation. I'd like to remind the administration that every time in your EIA, you will say you would do a fisheries assessment. Many assessment reports have said that there will just be a small impact on fisheries. But then, with regard to 3RS, you started to mention medium kind of impact. But your studies have been very general. You were only looking at fishery resources. And I can tell you that very often the administration will be telling us about infrastructure development in separate papers, and you would do assessment separately. But then there will be a cumulative effect from these projects. For example, you reclaim land from the sea, and then we have to make a detour when we go home because the channels, the navigation channels, may be too narrow. And sometimes we have to use more fuel as a result. As you know, the tank for our vessels will not be enlarged as a result, and also there will not be more berths provided for fishermen. Therefore, they think that when you reclaim land from the sea, you are not supporting them enough, and you are not achieving a win-win situation. Please do not just count votes. Please listen to us and try to balance the interests of different parties so you can win the support of the general public. And this time around, will you do a special fisheries study in this reclamation project? Mr. Low, as I said, we are very concerned about the impact of reclamation on fishermen. We have been in close liaison with fishermen. From 2013, we have had over a dozen meetings with fishermen. We did a general EIA. It is not a statutory EIA. In our upcoming study, we will do a statutory EIA. But in that general EIA, we already gave consideration to the three nearshore reclamations, including Sunny Bay and Silhoma. Sorry, I don't have time. I will interject. I'm saying that your EIA is based on fishery resources, but what about the mode of operation for fishermen? And we are not talking about fishery resources per se, but fisheries. I'm asking you whether you would take a different approach this time around when you do your studies. Do you get my question, Mr. Lau? We have heard Mr. Ho. We will try to see what we can do with the study. Mr. Michael Look, Chairman, just now Ms. Alice Mack talked about pre-project investigation of the ground. If the department cannot give an immediate answer, I hope they can give a reply in future papers. I'd like to ask another question. Just wait. I'll ask them. Did you finish answering Ms. Alice Mack's question just now? Did you finish your answer just now? I can supplement on investigation. You can do so in writing. Please give me back my time, Chairman. The FTU is more concerned about employment. In your study this time, you don't mention employment. There are about 200,000 people in Tung Chung. Many of them have to go to other districts for work. Disneyland and the airport are not offering enough jobs for Tung Chung residents. Your positioning is for a hub for recreation, leisure, and entertainment. Do you have information how many jobs can be created? And in your future studies, shouldn't you include employment as a priority economic development? Mr. Lai, I believe when this site is used for recreation, leisure, and entertainment, jobs will certainly be created. And in the upcoming study, we are going to look at what facilities will be built on the land, and we will be doing assessments on economic benefits and employment. Mr. Luke, let me add. The FTU would like to talk about the cycle track between Sunny Bay and Tung Chung at the Islands District Council. This has been mentioned before. I'd like to know whether you would take on board this one in your study. This will be considered as part of the study for land tile development. Mr. Luke is asking whether we can have a continuous cycle track from Sunny Bay to Tongcheng. That will be taken up in that study. Mr. Luke, I hope you will consider employment. Your answer to me just now was a little vague. Later on, when you consult the public and when you come back to Lechko to seek our support, I hope you will map out a clearer direction. Reclamation is a costly project. It is also controversial. If you do not have a plan to create employment, it will be difficult for us to support you. Next, Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chair. This morning, we went on a visit to the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge, and many members were saying that we should be proud because that is a major infrastructural project. I hope this kind of pride will not become a habit, that you would want to continue with infrastructural projects. First, we have to delineate the need first before embarking on a project. In fact, the Construction Industry Alliance talked to me before. They said they would like to maintain the workforce, and every year they need projects costing $70 billion every year from the government. But if this is the starting point for infrastructural projects, that is abnormal, because infrastructural projects are very costly and there is also an environmental cost. Take this project as an example. This is Sunny Bay Reclamation. Next to it, we have the Disney theme park phase 2. But that site of 60 hectares has been basking in the sun for over 10 years, but it's still reserved for Disney. And then in 2020, it will expire, but then it can be renewed for 5 years and another 5 years. My question for the administration is, the money to be used for Sunny Bay Reclamation, is it that there will be major difficulties, or should we resolve the land acquisition agreement with Disneyland in order to release the 60 hectares first? Which should be done first? Mr. Lai, I think we should consider whether we really have to pick one site out of the two. Our assessment is the Phase 2 Disney site will be reserved, and we are exploring having a Phase 2 for Disney as its long-term development. And also in Northeast Lantau, maybe we can also accommodate other tourist attractions with a variety.
It's updated.
The land has been vacant there, whether it's local tenants proposal or Alice Max proposal for employment opportunities. I think the easiest way, the fastest way to do is to use that. So my question is, under the Capital Works Reserve Fund, there's already a feasibility study on Sunny Bay included. Next one, Lan Chi Cheng. I think this study I very much supported, because at the meeting in the last legislative term, the opposition rejected the proposal, but now it's back with us again. Well, for this study, you want to turn the area for recreation and leisure purposes, but if that's the case, then you need to think of exploring new tourism spots. And also within this hatches of area, you need to see whether you can create employment opportunities. Otherwise, the reclamation itself, which is so costly, may not be worth the money spent. I know the study itself does not cost much, but it will be a costly sum when the time comes for the reclamation. So you need to tell us the future value of the area should the reclamation become reality. What sort of well, what is the effectiveness or benefits can we get from reclamation? So you need to do a detailed study on that before coming back to LegCo for funding support for the reclamation. Mr. Lai? Well, tourism industry is one of the four economic pillars of Hong Kong. Every year, it brought in 5% of our GDP to Hong Kong every year. As for the Sunny Bay reclamation, during the study proposed, we will look into the future use and also carry out a economic benefits analysis as part of the study. Okay, no more questions. Next one, Kwok Kak Hee. Chairman, I've never seen a big project like this on which there's no specific direction. The government says there is no land to build housing. There are 300,000 people waiting for public rental housing, waiting for 4 years or more. And the industrial land in Penny Bay has got an area of more than many hectares. And if you want to build up tourism facilities, so why don't you work on the land on loan to Disneyland? And secondly, if you want to make use of the site itself, well, much has been said about the industries in brownfield sites in the new territories, you know, occupying the area where making the site unsuitable for building public housing. So where has the government's brain gone? Are you going to planning to put all the logistics industry and storage of machineries in an area with much noise pollution and vacating land to build public housing? Wouldn't that be a better way out? Two questions. Why is that a more than 100 hectares of land not used to develop tourism, recreation, leisure facilities? The land has been available for 12 years. And also, secondly, why don't you vacate brownfield sites now built with heavy machineries to build public housing? Where for the 60 hectares of land in the second phase, as I said earlier, the government now, well, you've used up 60 hectares and you still have, there's a total of 300 hectares. What about the remaining ones? Are you still letting them lay their hands on it? Well, back to brownfield sites. I think on various occasions, the secretary has said that we are still studying. That is in the new town study to see how we can make good use and also release some of the brownfield sites. I'm asking you about Penny Bay, whether there can be any land vacated there to provide land available to build public housing in the new territories. Why can't we do that? Ms. Zhang, let me supplement. On brownfield sites in the new territories, we are carrying out a number of our studies. We're not asking about studies. I'm asking you, why can't you move those sites or lands to here? Because we need to carry out a more comprehensive approach, because brownfield sites, besides their own economic benefits, if we were to make good use of them, we need to do a comprehensive study first before releasing them for other purposes. I don't object to your doing the study, but you have got more than 100 hectares of newly reclaimed land. Why can't you use that? Next one, Lan Kwok Hong. I think let's not lose our temper. The government, you know, is very good at lying. Look at Si Wa Leung. The government is suing the nine organizers of the Occupy Central Movement. The whole world knew March 26th was the day for choosing the chief executive, and then the next day they arrested the nine people, nine of them altogether. Everything was planned. And yet, so please come back to this topic. Well, I'm just, please, you need to, if you want to comment on politics, please say that outside, not in this chamber. This is a meeting room. I just want to show that the government is not reliable. You cannot believe what it says. Please come back to this topic. Please be more straightforward. I know you are an executive counselor. This is not Home Affairs panel. This is a development panel meeting. The government that lied to the whole world, it had done everything, made all the preparations, and it had plans for specific days, and came up with excuse of just for the convenience of administration. It just used the administration convenience to hide its decision. So you're not really telling the whole truth here. Let me say this again. March 26, 27, everyone knew they were connected. Everyone knew what would happen, what's supposed to happen after the election. Can you come back to the topic, please? Okay. Well, look at Ho Chi Minh. He got 60 votes. And then because he got 60 votes, he could, you know, loudly, you know, blame the officials and say that if you don't give what we want, we could just veto your proposal. Well, he's got votes of more than almost one-tenth of votes that Carrie Lam got. Well, back to this topic. Justin, I was listening to Kwok Ka-Ki and his point about the 100 hectares of land. I asked Yong Wai Hung some time ago what he's going to do with the land. In Sunny Bay, I don't know how this idea came from. We talked to you before. Why was this proposal not approved in the last legislative term? Because we said that the ecology is very important. It's not that we don't want you to go ahead, but because of the ecology in Sunny Bay, you can't just go ahead with what you want to do. Next one, Chen Chi Chen. Thank you, Chairman. I want to follow up on Appendix 3, Paragraph 4 of the paper, where it says that if it uses an environmental method to build the seawalls and go for reclamation, if there are suitable mitigations, then the water quality, in terms of water quality, the microorganisms there will be in line with the standard. So the method that is mentioned here, is it the same as what we talk about? Is it the same as the non-dredged method we discussed for the Macau-Zhuhai Bridge, Hong Kong-Zhuhai Bridge? Is it that other kinds of methods would not be eco-friendly? And also, in the construction companies in Hong Kong, what about the technology of the Hong Kong construction companies? Do they have enough technology and skills to carry out such a eco-friendly method? We went to see the Hong Kong Macau-Zhuhai Bridge this morning, and they seemed to suggest that people there, the officials responsible for the project, did not seem to be worried about any harm caused to the ecology. But are we going to really go ahead with the construction method? Have you learned any lessons from the seawall incidents in the Hong Kong Macau-Zhuhai Bridge, Mr. Lai? I think this method of building construction reclamation is one that would not require dredging of mud. It was used also elsewhere, and there are also other methods, similar methods around in various countries. There are different ways to build seawalls, but they are non-dredging all the same. Because if you do dredge the mud, it would cause deterioration in the water quality. So the non-dredged method is more eco-friendly. Chairman, but on the other hand, I was asking, if we use the dredging method, the traditional dredging method, is it that we would not be able to comply with the environmental requirements? Is that what this paragraph means? But you said that you want to carry out further study, right? Yes, what we meant is that we carry on carrying out an overall environmental impact study. an overall study. In the future, when we carry out the planning and engineering study, we'll look more in depth into the construction method. So in the future, we'll review in more detail what sort of construction method is most desirable and what impact it will have. Next one, Chen Chong Tai. Thank you, Chairman. Last Wednesday, during the sitting, Yu Xinwei moved a motion concerning developing local tourism resources. And today, we are discussing the Sunny Bay Reclamation. I'd like to ask for the government and the establishment camp, Sunny Bay, have you ever looked carefully at whether there are any cultural relics or natural resources that could be damaged by reclamation? Mr. Lau? Yes, in our overall environmental impact assessment, we did a rough look and we so far haven't identified any monuments or cultural relics there. Sunny Bay itself, to its west, there's a small area with resources that are rich, ecologically speaking. The proposed reclamation site will bypass that area, so that small area would not be affected. In the future, in terms of developing lesser recreation facilities, we will also see whether there's any chance for leisure fishing or ecological tourism that can be provided there in the area of Sunny Bay. Chairman, my question is, besides ecology, honestly, well, I know that you've done the overall environmental impact assessment, and the paper last time said that you would begin the study in June, and you said that in 2014, June, you said that the Environmental Protection Department passed the study, and the government is supposed to carry out further study before June. It seems like the administration is confident about its time frame. But my question was, besides natural resources, based on some past reports, Sunny Bay, Lokiang, there are reports that there are some relics dating back to the Tang Dynasty because there are some kilns, ancient kilns discovered there. So there's history in the area. So has the administration considered if you go ahead with reclamation, it could damage some cultural relics? You know, that we can see a repeat of what happened in Ma Wan, you know, huge controversy when the development site turned out to be a important area filled with cultural relics. So I'd like to know whether you have, besides environmental impact assessment, whether have you ever done any study on local relics, cultural relics?
Mr. Lam Chek-ting. Thank you, Chair. The DP has always insisted that land out development should go by the principle of development in the north and conservation in the south. So we basically support this project. Mr. Michael Tian is asking that one of the objectives of the study should be to build a racetrack. We have reservations about that and we question the utilization rate. So it's a matter of cost effectiveness. We have grave reservations towards Mr. Michael Tian's motion. That's all. Mr. Holden Chow would like a second round, but sorry, we don't have time. We can only have this item until 3:05. As I said, there are two motions in my hands. One from Michael Tian, one from Jeremy Tam, and now we have another one, which is Jeremy Tam amending Michael Tian's motion. Mr. Michael Tian, why don't you go first, and then Mr. Jeremy Tam can comment on his amendment to your motion. Mr. Michael Tian.
Thank you, Chairman.
My motion is the result of incorporating many views of stakeholders. And I thank those people who gave me input. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, you spoke on behalf of the DP. In fact, I have changed the race track to multi-use sites. And it could be a marathon, it could be a cyclothon. If 80 hectares is used to build a track, it can provide a 4.5 km track. And 10 rounds would mean it is a marathon track. And if we hold marathons later, we will not have to close off our roads. And the marathon athletes are very interested. And I have talked to Mr. Shan, the bicycle coach. Ms. Sarah Lee has said that they now do not have any public roads for training cyclists. Therefore, this is going to be a multi-purpose site, and it is not just for mechanized vehicles. There can also be low-carbon uses. There will also be hotels, and we are only saying that the study should include these matters. I also agree that fisheries and marine ecology should also be assessed. That is why I think this study is worth it. After thorough discussion, the study should be comprehensive and touch upon all these aspects. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Thank you, Chairman. Let us look at Mr. Michael Tien's new motion. It is a new one and it is quite different from the last one. In fact, this has come after I submitted my motion. But Mr. Chairman, you have decided that if Michael Tien's motion is passed, Mr. Tam's motion will not be processed. You said supporting one means objecting to another, but I don't agree with you. In order to reiterate what I say in my motion, it is a simple thing. If you want to reclaim land from the sea, at least you have to tell me what you intend to do there. If it is going to be buildings, then you would have to explain to me why we need so much convention and exhibition space to the tune of 100 hectares. If you talk about other things like a racetrack, at least you tell me it is a racetrack. But you say nothing about that. You don't even tell me what the intended major uses are. You just say it could be used for recreation, leisure, and entertainment, but you don't provide any theme. You don't have any calculation of the land you need. It seems you are just going for reclamation for the sake of it. I can't support it at all. As I said, that site is subject to height and noise constraints. It is a flight path. You should therefore think again whether there should be reclamation, and if yes, for what? If all the details are absent, I cannot support it. That is why I have added this line to the amended motion of Michael Tien. And this is actually what my original motion said, and that is, without all the feasibility studies completed, you should not apply for funding. Okay, the two members have commented on their motions and the amendments. I will first ask members to vote on the amendment proposed by Mr. Jeremy Tam, not his own motion, but the amendment. Those in favor, please hold your hands in the air. Someone claims a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes. Members, I'd like you to go back to your seats because we are going to take the vote soon. That is to go back to your original seats. Please do not sit in other people's seats. And now I'd like to explain to you something. I'd like to mention to you that we are going to vote on Mr. Jeremy Tam's amendment to Mr. Michael Tin's motion. If this is carried, Mr. Michael Tin's motion will be amended. But if this is not carried, we'll vote on Mr. Michael Tin's motion. If that motion is not carried, then we can vote on Mr. Jeremy Tam's motion. Please proceed to vote now. Please press the presence button and then choose one of the other three buttons and press to express your stance as to whether you are in favor of the motion or against it, or you are abstaining. Before I declare the results, please check your votes, and voting is closed now. Results are displayed. 11 for, 20 against, no abstention. The motion, that is the amendment motion, is not carried. Now we'll vote on Mr. Michael Tin's motion. Do you claim a division? If not, those in favor, you want to claim a division? Okay, 5 minutes.
对不起啊, 你说什么话?
Sorry, what did you say? Can we change it to 1 minute? I already said 5 minutes. No one asked to shorten. I'm too late, right? We are already ringing the bell.
So please return to your seats. You're going to vote on Michael Tian's motion. It's now time to vote, please. Press the button. To indicate whether you support or reject the motion. So please check your vote. Now voting ends, please show the results. 17 in favor, 11 against, 3 abstention. I announce that the motion, Michael Tian's motion, is carried. So colleagues, because this is an item to be submitted to PWSC, so would you agree with that? Do you want to claim a division? Or do I just count the hands? Okay, you want to claim a division? Okay, I want to know whether you can you reduce the bell ringing time to 1 minute? This will be the last time. Any objection? I was asking you. If you want to be quick, just raise your hands, then we can count your hands and know who are against and who are in favor. It's very easy. In that case, you don't have to claim a division. You want to claim a division, and then you only want 1 minute. Can you just raise your hands? Instead, no? You want to claim a division? Okay, 5 minutes. So members, please return to your seats. Okay, we're going to vote to see whether we support submitting the paper to PWSC. So it's now time to vote. Members, please press the button to indicate your presence and then indicate your vote. Okay, voting ends. Oh, well, please verify your vote first. Okay, now voting ends. Show the results, please. 22 for, 11 against, 0 abstention. So we'll wrap up this item, the next one. Encouraging property owners to participate in smart tender scheme. Electrical papers, CB bracket 1699/16-17/06. So let's invite the administration to come in. So let's welcome, well, to save time, I'll just extend a formal welcome to Secretary for Development, Mr. Eric Ma, and his colleagues. I would not repeat and mention their names. So this proposal is a funding request. So based on Section 83A of the Rules of Procedures, if members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in relation to this item, members concerned should declare the interest before speaking. So let me remind you, in the previous item, we're supposed to end at 3:05, and this item should have been wrapped up at 3:40. We have a 3-hour meeting today already, so I have no intention to further extend this meeting. So to save time, you know, if you can save time, then we can deal with more items today. Because we only reserved 35 minutes for this item. So far, members who've raised their hands include those who are in the queue to speak up. They include Lok Chung Hong, Chia Wai Chun, Lo Kok Fen, Kok Ka Ki, Nathan Law, Lam Chia Ting, Chen Chen Ying, Yu Si Wing, Yu Chung Yim. Two more, Lan Chi Cheng, and Oh Chun Sing. Any more? Any other colleagues who want to speak, please indicate now. Those who are seated, please indicate now. Because we don't have enough time. We've got 11 members who've asked to speak. 12? Roland Kwok Hong. Roland Kwok Hong, don't mention March 26, 27 again. So I think for this item, well, since there's so many members who want to speak, I need to give each of you at least 4 minutes, but I will need to be very strict with the time. The 4 minutes must include question and answer. And so please, the administration, please watch the time as well. If you can't give a full answer here, please provide answer in writing instead. First one, Noh Chung Hong, 4 minutes. Look, I'm Lok Chung Hong. I'm Lok, not Law. Okay, it's fine. So I'd like to welcome this scheme first of all, but I've got several questions. First is, in the pilot scheme stage, have you received from any owners or owners corporation about complaints about bid rigging, and what are the statistics involved? And how have you helped with the owners to take action or carry out investigation on the suspected contractors? And how about the integrity or reputation of the contractors being used now? What mechanism is there now? Because a number of applicants have tried to attract bids. But now if you want to expand the work of facilitation, then your workload will increase. So does the ERA have got any plan to increase its manpower? Secretary, I will ask my colleague from Urban Renewal Authority to answer, because in the past they've carried out some new arrangements for bidding, so they have accumulated some experience. So maybe I invite Mr. Ho to supplement. Mr. Ho?
Thank you, Chairman.
On the smart tender scheme, I'd like to talk about the scope of the scheme. Basically, smart tender, well, those who are eligible are single block private buildings or composite buildings. New territories, village houses are not included. And the buildings itself must have its own owners and corporation. So what does it involve? Well, the owners of these domestic or composite buildings, before they hire consultants, it's best for them to join the scheme at that stage before they have the consultants. And we will give them a tool kit or handbook to guide them in how to carry out repair maintenance works, the procedures involved.
There are also standard templates to help them engage the consultant and a contractor. We have engaged an independent consultant. So before owners engage their own consultant, this consultant of ours will give an initial estimate to the owners basing on what maintenance is necessary. So owners can get prepared. After they have engaged a consultant, we will still advise the owners, we will tell them how a consultant should be engaged. That consultant will do an investigation report, he will draft the tender documents and also give a quotation. And then we will again give advice on the consultant's work with regard to pricing and other things. When tender documents have been prepared, our consultant will look at the tender documents and comment on them. And we will also give them an estimate for the contractor. That estimate will be put in a sealed envelope and it will be inserted in the tender box. When tenders are opened, the owners can then make a comparison as to whether the bids they receive are at a reasonable level. What should owners do when they have the tender documents? They will use the electronic platform. Next, Mr. Po, Chair. Let us revisit what is happening. 48 applications, 39 have been approved. Why 9 have not been approved? Why is it that there is a low level of application now? And also, from your experience, and according to your tiered approach, which tier do the approved applications belong to? I'm talking about para 8. Should we improve upon the tiers? I support your relaxation of the approach, but it seems those who are least able to support the cost will receive the lowest concession, which is 5%. but other people with a higher rateable value will be able to enjoy the highest 50% concession. Why are you not helping those who are least financially able? Certainly, there is a lot of subsidy. When you screen your so-called independent professionals, what criteria do you use? Will there be a monitoring mechanism? And also, are you going to affect the professionals' private market? Mr. Chair, thank you for your views. In paragraph 7, we have said that the first tier relates to smaller units with a lower rateable value. This means they only pay 5%. In fact, they receive 95% subsidy, which is the highest. As for the last tier and what cases have been handled, I think I can defer to Mr. Ho. Mr. Ho, until yesterday, we have received 65 applications. 48 have been approved. 10 are the subject of further documents submission, but another 7 have withdrawn applications. We made several requests, but then they have not been able to submit documents before the deadline. Another one, owners wanted to join another scheme, so they cancelled their application. The choice of an independent professional, we use a tendering system as well. And we choose only from the list of the government and the list of the URA. In the process, if we send them to a project at a certain building, they will have to take an oath or make a declaration beforehand that he is not related to that building. And also, all his reports have to be seen by us before they go to the owners. How do you choose who can be a professional for your projects? Well, the list usually contains engineering people or surveyors. They have knowledge about projects. You say the number of applications is still small. Is it because of the fee that has to be paid? You say it is best to apply before the project goes ahead. Is it that there will be no approval if the project is completed already? Well, we launched the scheme in May last year. We charge a fee, and we believe owners may have second thoughts because there is a fee to be paid. Edward Lau, smart tender is a good thing. The $300 million will be well spent. I welcome it. There is a suspected bid rigging. It is because the market is not transparent. There is not enough information going around, and the owners have no professional view. Smart tender arranges professionals to do estimation and help draft tender documents, and also there is an e-platform. I believe all this will help reduce the risk of manipulation or intervention. However, the utilization rate of the scheme has been low. I think you need to do more publicity. My first question is whether you will do more publicity. Number two, sometimes people think they do not receive all the help they need. Well, during the tendering process, you can help them a lot by selecting the bid for them. But as you know, tendering is one thing, but implementation is another. Owners also need help in monitoring the project and taking over the project. The smart tender scheme is not helping owners do this. And owners are telling us they hope the STS can help them take over project after it is completed. Secretary, can you consider expanding the scope of the project to include taking over? This time around, you are giving a commitment of $300 million. the DAB has been proposing the setting up of a building maintenance monitoring council, so your service will be regularized. If the $300 million will be popular with owners, will you consider setting up a council so you can regularize the services from tendering to taking over of the project? Secretary, a brief reply from me. The scheme was launched by the URA using its own resources in May last year. So we have only got a few months and we see dozens of applications. It is not very far from our target. If we can give them financial support, we hope we can do more publicity. We'll follow up on that. As for taking over the project, I think Mr. Ho can supplement. And we hope we can gauge the effect of the scheme in the coming few years, and there will be a review done at the appropriate time. Mr. Ho, STS aims to help owners to engage contractors in a fair and open manner. But the quality of work and the progress of work of contractors, that should be overseen by the consultant engaged by the owners incorporated. If the monitoring is not sufficiently done, well, they can engage an independent inspector of works to help them. I hope the secretary can step up publicity. There are new amendments to Cap 344. I hope you will cooperate with HAB, which can help you publicize the project to owners incorporated. Mr. Nathan Law. Thank you, Chairman. Three questions. Number one, there will be a third-party independent expert. I'd like to know whether you engage these people through public tendering or public recruitment. And the OIs who are joining this scheme will be given a DIY toolkit. I'd like to know whether that will be made available to the public. If the public do not join the scheme, but they can also get the information from the DIY toolkit, you can benefit all the OCs in Hong Kong. Number three, the number of OCs. You have $300 million now and you expect 3,000 applications, but you have received only 48 since May last year. I believe the applications are way below your expectation. You said there may be a problem of the fee, but I was doing the sum. If it is a big estate, each household will only have to pay a few hundred dollars so they can take part in the scheme. I believe a few hundred dollars is not a big sum of money for large estate households. Do you know whether there are other reasons which have kept the owners away? I have heard that there are triad societies involved and the owners were afraid they would be retaliated. Secretary, let me explain. Last year, the STS was started by URA with its own resources and the fees are still the existing fees. When the total fee has to be paid, we still have received over 60 applications since May last year. Going forward, I understand that. I have asked the questions. Please answer my questions. I have to ask Mr. Ho to answer your questions with regard to the third-party advisor and also the toolkit. Mr. Ho.
Thank you, Chairman.
We will go through a tendering process to engage the independent third-party advisor. and they are selected from the URA and also the government's lists. We invite them to submit tenders. Number two, the DIY toolkit. We can consider uploading it to the URA building maintenance platform. Let me clarify, does it mean it will be available to everybody instead of just those people in the scheme? Well, that platform is open to the public. The third one, publicity and other factors keeping people away from the scheme. What is your experience? Ever since May, we have done publicity in different ways. At different times, we have sent out letters to 2,200 OCs. No, sorry, I don't need a report. I'm just asking you whether you know there are other factors keeping them away apart from monetary concern. Well, I was going to say I did a lot of publicity. I don't know why people are not coming forward. Next, Mr. Lam Chuk Ting. I know why they are not coming forward. Many management companies and people in the industry make use of lies and excuses to prevent owners from taking part. I have been to owners' committees, and the so-called maintenance consultants would say that their tendering approach is exactly the same as that under the STS. That is, of course, wrong information given to small owners. I hope the URA and the Bureau will step up publicity of the scheme. The participation rate is low. It shouldn't be that low, because I know your scheme can help the small owners. If you do publicity, more people will take part.
Enjoy.
I'd like to say to the administration, there are tens of applicants now. So I think if you lower the fee, and the residents have told me that, you know, they joined the scheme at an early stage and yet they had to pay more. So now you have been given $30 billion, would you further reduce the fee then? And secondly, for UOA, well, he has some subsidized schemes, like, for example, a scheme for maintenance of buildings. I think various subsidized schemes are mutually exclusive. So would you consider relaxing the criteria so that homeowners can join various subsidy schemes so that they wouldn't lose the chance of joining Smart Tender because of their involvement in other schemes? And also for inviting tenders, you actually need to look at the procedures involved. So when the time comes for them to sign a contract, are the provisions the same as what was agreed at the time of choosing a bidder? I saw cases in which, you know, a construction company or contractor may promise this and that, but by the time comes for the writing of contract, the provisions in the contract end up being different after the contract is signed because of collusion between the contractor and the lawyers or other parties involved. So please look into that. And thirdly, I'd like to talk to Mr. Y. As Managing Director of URA, you should not be involved in the CE election. This smart tender says that it is... you said that the Democratic Party actually helped support this scheme, but how can you maintain your political neutrality when you are actually supporting one CE election candidate? Well, Mr. Lam, please focus on the topic. Director, well, I'd like to thank Mr. Lam for his support for the scheme. We'll continue to enhance our publicity and public and education among the public, and also we'll try to help owners and corporation. We need to let them know the choices available. So, Secretary, I know that there are many people who join the scheme, but they found that they pay a higher than expected fee. So I think Mr. Wei can explain further. Mr. Wei. I think so far there have been 4 applications approved. Some were charged a previous fee. We charge fees at 3 different stages. So far, the 4 applications have not finished the entire process. And we may give the applicants, some of the applicants, rebates of some of the fees paid. Okay, next one, Mr. Chen Chenying. Thank you, Chairman. I very much welcome more concessionary raised to encourage owners to take part in smart tender. But in paragraph 4 of the paper, under URA, the fee only reflects partly the cost incurred by the URA in providing the service. So now we have a budget of $30 billion to lower the fee of smart tender. Yet at the same time, the URA in providing the service needs to pay for other out-of-pocket expenses. So that means the cost for the whole scheme should be more than $30 billion. So does the administration have any idea what is the actual amount needed? And also, under smart tender, it states that it will not accept phased services. That is, if you only provide one part of service at the stage, then that's not accepted. But now we have reduced the fee to 5 to 10%. So now with the reduced fee, can we consider, or the government, can it accept phased services so that, you know, owners who've used other consultants in stage 1 and stage 2, because of phased services, they can come back, you know, to smart tender and use this service to finish off their maintenance work. Mr. Y, the $30 billion actually is the amount given out by the government to support smart tender. The URA also has to pay for some of the costs for phased charging of fees. You know, some fees could be at some stage could be as low as a few thousand only. So I think under the various stages of fee paying, each phase actually involves a very small amount. But if you want to further reduce it or increase the number of stages, that could be difficult. But Mr. Ho, can you supplement? Yeah, smart tender is about a service to let owners hire contractors in an open, fair manner. We hope that the owners can have access to the whole process. If it only use a particular document to invite tenders, that would not be of much help. I hope that owners can enjoy the entire process of service. Mr. Chen? Yes, in the smart tender document, it says that at some stage, if the owner wants to enjoy the service, that cannot be facilitated. But I'm saying that, you know, what about if a tender wants to, or the owner wants to get smart tender to support part of the project? So can the owner's concern have the flexibility? Yes, we'll consider giving owners flexibility. Why is it that we did not accept phased services or services carried out over a number of stages because we didn't want to get a consultant hired through improper means? But if a contractor has carried out the first stage of work, and if the bidding documents and the work done is up to our standard, then we may give the owners more flexibility. Okay, next one, Yu Shi Wing. Thank you, Chairman. Just then, Mr. Ho talked about getting third-party independent experts. So I was away for a while, so I'd like to follow up on how can you make sure that the independent third-party experts are neutral and fair? Are there penalties involved for you know, problematic so-called independent third-party experts? And secondly, in inviting tenders, Home Affairs Department used to play a role in that it would help with inviting tenders. So with this scheme, would there be any further division of work with the Home Affairs Department? And thirdly, with the concessionary rates, owners pay from $1,000 to $3,000. But there are some unit owners who are elderly. You can't even afford to pay the thousands of dollars. So is there any mechanism for them to be given subsidy? So in the future, when they have to carry out maintenance or repair work, they can have some deductions? Mr. Ho? First of all, I'd like to talk about the independent third-party expert. We hired them they have to make a disclaimer that they have no interest involved in the building maintenance work. And whatever report submitted by the expert will be looked at by us, and it has to be reasonable to us and comply with our standard before we show it to the owners. And as for the Division of Work with Home Affairs Department, we've been working with the department all along, and under the scheme, the department has, as usual, always set up or help owners set up owners in corporation to take part in the scheme. Thirdly, as for owners who are in financial difficulty, as I just said, they will be invited to take part in our subsidy scheme for maintenance and repair. Okay, you see, Wing? Okay, back to question one. Would there be any penalties? Justin, you were saying that there is a system in existence, but what if, if there are penalties, then at least it would have greater deterrent effect. Is there any piece of legislation or any sort of penalty at all? Mr. Ho, well, whenever we hire any consultant, we will regularly evaluate their performance. So if the performance is not up to standard, we will not invite them again. But after all, we talk about large-scale works. The independent third party will be recommended by you. So how many so-called experts do you have on your list? Or we just talk about a small number of people who are actually on the list? Well, first of all, we would look at the items that each consultant would be responsible for on the government's register or the URA's register. There is a certain number of consultants. There are enough of them for us to choose from. So do they have to apply to be on your register, or would you just use existing register to make recommendations to the owners? Or is it that owners have to accept whatever recommendation you provide them with? Yu Chung-Yim, let me make a declaration. I'm vice chairman of the owners incorporation of a large-scale residential project in Pok Fu Lam, and this estate is using URA's smart tender scheme. I welcome Mr. Wise Porn. We actually have paid $660,000, so we can apply for exemption immediately. But anyway, back to this topic. As a user, I can see that URA's involvement is very low. It's just giving opinions or find a consultant to source another consultant. I think the biggest drawback is that is, in terms of the eligibility of contractor, I think URA is little involved in vetting contractors. You only have access to electronic platform. So I talked to the URA before, and the URA ultimately decided to add the two envelope system. And there isn't any pre-qualification system adopted as well. So that would actually create problems for the problems with the eligible contractors, because some of them may not be eligible ones, may not have the necessary assets or standards. And also, finally, there isn't a blacklist system. Some contractors, even though they are bad elements, and yet they're still allowed to bid. So in terms of the vetting of the qualifications of bidders, what can you do to improve the current system? Mr. Y? Well, I think I haven't answered the previous question. I was saying that we will consider give rebates of what has been paid. That's the consideration of management, but it needs to be approved by our board. So we will make this proposal to our board on offering rebates. And on the other question, building maintenance and bidding for that is a very complicated issue. We cannot just rely on one organization or measure to solve the problem. So we are considering setting up a maintenance platform with two functions. One is that could provide a one-stop consultation center, so people can know from the platform immediately where are the subsidy and how they can choose the contractors, the best contractors, and also the templates for contracts as well. And also, we want to also compile a list to be uploaded onto the platform of contractors or even inspectors of works, so that the list of eligible professionals could be put on the website, and then owners would know who are worth considering. But you haven't answered my question. Would you do pre-vetting, or would there be a blacklist of underperforming or substandard contractors? In creating the platform, we will consider what we can put on it. For big maintenance projects, we would stay in the guidelines that there should be this provision for pre-qualification and so forth. So platform itself will be managed by URA, and we also set up committees in the sector and also get government departments to be consultants. How about we, as the first batch of guinea pigs, can we ask for the incorporation of such a system, you know, having access to such a system yet? Well, we haven't created it yet. So we are the pigeon, you know, guinea pigs, and yes, we were not entitled to such a platform. But if you were being guinea pigs, you can, well, you can wait.
No, there has been an order from the building's authority. I have asked for 4 extensions, and no more extensions would be allowed. Mr. Leung Chi Chang. The STS is good reference and good advice for owners. We are aware that the STS will only help owners identify a bid, and then the contractor and work inspection will all be left to the owners. Perhaps if you only help to that extent, and if the works are found to be substandard in the end, there may be litigation. Of course, the scheme is a smart tender scheme, and you stop with tendering. Can you not expand the scope to help take over the project after it is completed? Owners Incorporated are not that knowledgeable. Can you do more? Secretary, can I defer to Mr. Ho? Actually, we already explained this. The takeover effort is not just at the end of the project, and in fact, monitoring has to be done throughout the process. I think Mr. Ho can explain. Mr. Ho, work inspection and monitoring, as I explained, should be done by the project consultant hired by the building owners. Owners should also engage a work inspector to keep track of the project throughout. If you only take a look every now and then, it will not be good enough. Even if you go and audit the project from time to time, it's not good enough, because there may be some problems relating to the building itself, and the owners will be at a loss if the examination result will be different from what the project consultant says. Therefore, we always say you should hire a work inspector, and only that can help owners. After a contractor is engaged, if the owners should find that the project is problematic and they want to ask questions, we will still answer you. We will give you advice if you call us. Nothing else. Mr. Wilson Orr, thank you, Chairman. There will be $300 million more public money to help owners. I welcome it. But I have a question for the Bureau. Para 11. In 5 years, you expect to help 3,000 organizations. Starting from October 2016 to February 2017, in about half a year, you only got 48 applications, with 39 having been approved. So on what basis did you come up with the figures in Para 11? If you can't achieve that target, who will be held responsible? Secondly, I always say, no matter how good a scheme is, we have to publicize it. I think publicity is a big problem. I have proposed many times to the URA that you should use different publicity channels. You say you have distributed pamphlets, etc. I think you are not contacting the residents. Perhaps you can engage ambassadors who will go to the districts. Maybe you can cooperate with the HAD or the OCs to look for your targets in the district, or else the participation rate will still be low. The Bureau or the URA, will you have plans to do publicity? And number three, I hope there can be more participation by the URA. How can owners be protected from bid rigging? I can't see the participation extent of the URA from the paper. Can we be told how the URA can really help the small owners after a consultant is engaged? And then number four, the eligibility of contractors. Very often, we know that you have a criteria list for identifying contractors. If they are not up to standard or there is any problem at all, what can we do? Will you refer the matter to law enforcement agencies or professional bodies? When there are problems, and if this has to do with the consultant, how can the Bureau or the URA monitor such? Chairman, from 2016, we have only got a few months, and the scheme is just starting. There is room to do more publicity. We'll actively follow up on it so that our service targets know about the scheme. Now I will ask Mr. Y to talk about assessment and also the eligibility of contractors. Mr. Y, Para 11, we say that we hope there will be 3,000 owners, organizations, or 4,500 buildings in the next 5 years. We estimate that in the first year there will be 500 to 600. Those who are receiving our subsidy under the integrated scheme, there will be 300-400. And therefore, if together with this concession, we expect to be able to benefit about 600 buildings in the first year. Mr. Jonathan Ho, we welcome STS. I know that OCs have been collecting money from the small households so that they can take part in STS. I'd like to ask whether some owners are indeed applying for STS and forgoing their right to apply for other subsidies up to $1 million. Can you allow them to also apply to other schemes so they can reduce their maintenance cost? Secondly, I know you are a small team only. I believe with the concession, there will be more people applying. Will you engage more manpower so you can help more people? The Bureau, please. Chairman, if we have to cope with more cases, I'm sure the URA will deploy manpower accordingly. As for other subvention schemes, maybe Mr. Y can tell you the situation. I know some small owners want to apply for STS and they forwent some other subsidies. Mr. Y, the short reply is if they apply to STS and they forgo other subsidy schemes, now they can apply again. Is it that they have to do so before their projects start? We will tackle that with flexibility. Good. I think this is a good strategy. I hope more people will apply. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok.
Thank you, Chairman.
I'd like to talk about the independent third-party advisor. If he underperforms, what can the owners do? Any remedies? Or, on the other hand, if he really does a good job and the owners would like to continue to engage him, will there be a conflict of interest? And does this advisor have to declare potential conflict of interest? I think Mr. Ho can explain about the third-party advisor. The independent third-party advisor that we engage is asked to make a declaration upon engagement that he is not related to the building maintenance work concerned. Mr. Ma said owners might like to retain him. I think there is a conflict of interest. It is not allowed in principle. The consultants' reports will be seen by us before they are forwarded to owners. We can keep track of his standards and performance. If the reports are not reasonable, if he does not do the good job, he will not be hired again. Mr. Y, I'd like to explain. The first party is the owner, the second one is the consultant hired by the owners, and the third party is a consultant hired by us. He helps to give information to the owners. So we are the contracting party with this third party. We can penalize him if he does not perform well. The third party, you mean, has no direct working relationship with the owners. That is correct. There is no contractual relationship. He helps to give views on our behalf to the owners, meaning there is no working relationship. Well, he is in touch with the owners, but he has no contractual relationship with them. If there are no other members wanting to speak, I will wrap up this item. Next one, PWP item number 363WF, upgrading of disinfection facilities in water treatment works. We'll ask the administration team to come in. We have papers CB bracket 1699 bracket 07 prepared by the administration. Attending for this item, we have
其實呢度呢個。
Attending for this item, we have Mr. Vitus Ng, PAS for Development, Mr. Luke Wai Hong, Assistant Director for Water Supplies, and Mr. Chen Tak Yong, Chief Engineer from Water Supplies, Mr. Kelvin Kwok, Chief Chemist from Water Supplies. We are still trying to catch up with our schedule. I know you have a PowerPoint, but I would always tell you that you should not read out the slides one by one. If you're going to do that, we'll delay your item to next month. Now you can do an introduction. Thank you, Chairman. We'll introduce 363WF, upgrading of disinfection facilities in water treatment works briefly. We'd like to apply for $875.6 million to supply and install chlorine generation plant in 11 major water treatment works. Now I'd like to hand over to the WSD to briefly introduce the paper, and then we'll be taking questions. I will start using the PowerPoint. I'm reminding you that we have the PowerPoint and we can read. You don't have to read out the PowerPoint. We can read ourselves. You have to be brief. I have time. If you want to delay matters, go ahead. In Hong Kong, WTS uses chlorine, and it is from Guangdong, and there are transportation and disinfection risks. But now we have this membrane technology, and we can install these chlorine generation plants in our WTW so that we can reduce the risk of transportation and storage of chlorine.
So this is picture of the facility at the treatment works. We've asked Environmental Protection Department and Fire Services Department to determine that it is safe installation, and this is the implementation details. I'm not going to cover them one after another. So we'll install this chlorination facilities, and we'll begin shortly the installation, and we need a budget of $800 million. In terms of risk, chlorine, in terms of storage and transportation, and the risk will be greatly reduced with the installation while producing the same amount of chlorine. And the operating cost with the new facility, you know, will be cheaper by 30% comparing to buying the chlorine gas. Well, this is a funding proposal. So according to Section 83A of the Rules of Procedures, any members with direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please make declarations before you speak. So two members are in the queue. Any others? Ma Fong Kwok and Leung Chi Chang. Each will have 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Earlier on, government officials have explained this plan to me, but I don't understand about paragraph 8. It says that because of the small amount of chlorine gas used it for water treatment work, so you're not going to have the production of chlorine gas there. So my question is, why can't you focus on just a few large treatment works using the same technology so as to provide the liquid chlorine for dissemination to other smaller works, treatment works? Who will answer? Mr. Luke. At water treatment works, chlorine is the best for dissatisfaction. Sodium hydroxide can also be useful, but if you want to transport gas to other places, you need to have a different equipment. And whereas for sodium hydroxide, you can actually transport them, but in comparing the cost, we would think that at large disinfection facilities that we can have the chlorine gas produced. So you have done an analysis of the costs, right? So you think the current proposal is the best, right? Yes. You haven't given us any statistics or formula you use in doing your calculations of costs. Well, based on our plans, the last line says that the new facilities, it will be $19,000. Existing facility is $26,500 per ton. So it's a reduction of about 30% the cost. So for small treatment works, we will produce sodium hydroxide. Whereas for large treatment works, we will use the chlorine gas. How about using more of the sodium hydroxide? And I know the cost will go up. Is that the case? If you ask the FC for money, would you do the calculation for us to give us more information? Maybe let me try to explain. For using sodium hydroxide, comparing with chlorine gas, the hydroxide would take up 10 times the space. So for water treatment works, it uses about 6 tons of chlorine gas for disinfection purpose. If you replace that with sodium hydroxide, that would pose a huge burden in transporting the element. So it's not feasible in Hong Kong. And also the process of creating hydroxide also will release the chlorine gas. Use the chlorination generator to produce the gas itself, that will be the most effective way. But for small water treatment works, we cannot use chlorine gas because there isn't suitable supply of a small amount of chlorine gas equipment. Therefore, we need to get chlorine gas converted into sodium hypochlorite before they are being transported to small water treatment works. And also for sodium hypochlorite, when it's produced, it will over time reduce or lose its power in disinfection. So therefore, we must maintain fresh sodium hypochlorite. Mr. Ma, do you support this funding request? I do. Okay, next one, Leung Chi Chung. Thank you, Chairman. Okay, I do support this funding request, but just some clarifications. I think generally sodium hypochlorite is used to disinfect water, but for large water treatment works, if you are to have the facility to create chlorine gas, in the process of producing the gas, would there be the risks of, for example, chlorine gas will be harmful to human body when it's inhaled? And also, will the chlorine gas have fire risks? So how can you give nearby residents the confidence that the installation is safe? Let me try to explain. In many treatment works, we do store chlorine gas, and we have facilities to provide protection against leakage of the chlorine gas. So there will be similar leakage prevention facility at the future generation equipment. So when exposed to the air, there's very few time when the chlorine gas will be exposed to the air because it will be dissolved in water very quickly. So when the gas is not needed, we will not produce it. Therefore, the risk is really low. In the water treatment works, we have to save 90 days of the chlorine. But now we don't have to save any of them at all with the new generation equipment. Okay, any more questions? Liberal Party support this proposal. What about the others? Okay, we do. How about FTU? Okay, no other members want to speak? Okay, well, we'll wrap up this item. Next item is PWP item number 356WF, upgrading of Tung Chung Freshwater Supply System. We have the same officials with us, right? Who is the next to speak to us? I think we have with us Mr. Lok, Mr. Young, and Mr. Winters. Our paper is CB1699-1667-08. And the government wants to show us a PowerPoint, right? If you're ready, you can take us through the PowerPoint. Thank you. In Tung Chung, right now, we have a population of about 80,000. And our surface reservoir has an area of about 40 square meters. With the development of the new town there, the population will grow to 200,000. So we need to build a new surface reservoir with a storage of 40,000 cubic meters to cope with the future needs of the Tung Chung new town. The surface reservoir will be right next to the old reservoir. So we have done the site formation work, and it will not cause any nuisance to the Tung Chung downtown. You know, I mean the construction work itself. We have noted that there will be no resumption of private land, and there will be no long-term adverse environmental impact, no adverse impact to existing traffic network and so forth. And there will also be an aesthetically pleasant greening design for blending in with the environment. The dark green area on the slide will be the future reservoir, and there will be trees, vegetation surrounding the reservoir, so nearby residents will not see the proposed reservoir. We've consulted the district committees and the district council concerned, so we hope that you can support our funding request so that we can submit this to FC. Because this is a funding proposal, let me remind you, according to Section 83A of the Rules of Procedures, members with direct or indirect pecuniary interest with this topic, please make a declaration before you speak. So three colleagues have raised their hands. Helena Wong, Wong Kai Ming, Holden Chow, who've asked to speak, Leung Chi Cheung as well. Each one of you will have 4 minutes, including the answer. Helena Wong, we understand that we need to build the reservoir, surface reservoir, but I'd like to ask about the project itself. In paragraph 18, it says that it will fell 548 trees. And then after that, you will replant 348 trees there. And there'll be grassland as well. So I'd like to ask, is it necessary to fell the trees? Because, I mean, is the land right now filled with trees? Who would answer? Mr. Look? Yes. Right now, as you can see from the slide, the light green area is the existing surface reservoir. The dark green area is a temporary slope on site. So we did the site formation work before the construction, so we built the slope there, and after the slope was built, we planted some trees. There are about 418 trees on the temporary slopes planted 20 years ago. So on this area, we have actually grown grassland above the existing surface reservoir. We will in Suho 1 plant more than 380 trees as a compensation. In other words, in the original site, the trees fell could not be planted there because the surface reservoir will be right below them, so you can only have grassland above the reservoir. Yes. So in other words, there will be a green grassland there above the reservoir. So in the future and right now, can the public go to the area, reservoir area, for recreational purpose? Well, there'll be much chlorine there. Well, I think in accordance with normal procedure, we'll ask the LCSD whether they want to provide any recreational facility for the public. But the LCSD replied to us that they don't see a need for such facility there. But we do hope to see proper management, and we have an open attitude. If any sports committee wants to use the site, they can apply to LCSD, and with the department's support, we can consider opening up the site to the public. I know the service reservoir in Shakimei, Boundary Street, many people like to go hiking there to exercise, for example. So in the future, would it have to be organized groups who can apply to go there, or can any individuals just go there as they like without applying? I think it depends on the need. Right next to it is a part of a country park. So there are nearby trails, there are nice hiking trails there in the vicinity. So is it that individuals will not be allowed to go to the service reservoir? Mr. Look, for service reservoir, there are some all sorts of facilities there. We don't want any person to go there for fear of polluting the water. And we don't want to see individuals just go there and in and out of the area, out of the service reservoir, because we need to manage the site. So there has to be proper management on who can get in there. So we need to consult the LCSD first. If the department wants to use it, it will have proper management procedures so as to avoid the water being contaminated. Chairman, my understanding is that the service reservoir above it will be grassland, and you know, I mean, there's a big water tank, enclosed a big water tank under the grassland. If people do exercise above it, you know, on the grassland, how can they contaminate the water in the water tank at all? Well, you might want to give her a written reply later on. Do you support this item? Well, I need to wait for the answer first. Well, you can wait. Next one, Ho Kai Ming. Chairman, we have received an inquiry from our union that in Tung Chung Shah Shui Mo, in the rural area, it is a rural position and is considered part of Hong Kong Island. In the paper, paragraph 19, it says that it will, there were some additional posts created. So when the construction is completed, will the Tung Chung water supply system hire more workers to maintain the water supply system?
Tung Chung is not a rural area anymore. It is a new town. If you still use rural facilities for Tung Chung, there will be a problem. There was the bursting of a pipe and the entire Tung Chung was not supplied with water. I'd like to ask about the manpower contingent for operating the supply system. Mr. Luke, the WSD is always monitoring whether we have enough people in each grade. And according to the existing mechanism, we are also applying for recurrent expenditure while we apply for project funding. And that would include having more people to do operation, maintenance, and repair. We won't tell you exactly how many people will be hired just for this project because it's a small one. But for Lantau and Tung Chung development, we will look at the needs. We will communicate with our staff to understand their workload, and then we will arrange for more people internally. But you are not telling me whether you are going to recruit more people. I can't say now. It depends on the need. But your staff are telling us that there is a lot of pressure. Tung Chung has a big population, but then the manpower contingent is just that designated for a rural area. And if there is the bursting of a pipe, they just cannot cope. I hope the department can give us a figure to let us know whether more people will be recruited to maintain the security of water supplies for Lantau and Tung Chung. I can supply the information after the meeting. Does the FTU support this funding request? Yes, we do. Next, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. Tung Chung will eventually house 280,000 people. I'm sure we need this new service reservoir, and I will support this project in principle. But I have a question. We understand that you are going to fell trees. According to the paper, it's a big number. You are going to fell 548 trees. According to the paper, you would plant back 348 trees. Where are you going to plant these trees? What are the details? Because you are going to fell a big number of trees. Mr. Luke.
Yes.
Our paper says we are going to plant 348 trees. 118 will be planted in situ, and then 200 at Soho 1 water treatment works. Is that okay? Yes, thank you. Thank you for the reply. Mr. Leung Chi Chang, Chairman, two questions. One, according to your paper, you will be able to supply 80,000 cubic meters per day. In Tongchong, there will be 150,000 people, but my memory tells me the big figure should be bigger. If you complete reclamation projects, the population figure should be over 200,000. And your planning horizon is only 2020. What about beyond that? Supposing 5 to 10 years beyond that, will the supply still be sufficient? And then number six, you say you call this a new contract. Now, I don't exactly understand what you mean. You call this a new engineering contract. And in the footnote, you say it's a suite of contracts developed by the Institution of Civil Engineer United Kingdom. It is a contract form that emphasizes cooperation, mutual trust, and collaborative risk management. What is meant by that? Number one, supply volume. This project is only responsible for the yellow part or Tongchong New Town. The CEDD will submit other papers to the panel for 786 CL, and there will be funding for increasing water supplies facilities. We have a clear division of labor between ourselves and the CEDD. As for the new engineering contract, it is introduced from the UK. It talks about mutual trust. Apart from the normal contract, there will be risk expectation, and engineers and contractors will have to maintain good communication. One successful example is the Happy Valley project that has just been completed. It saved $60 million in contract sum. And just last week, the financial secretary hosted the opening ceremony, and I can give you more information about new engineering contracts if you want. Dr. Edward Yu,
thank you, Chairman.
I can compliment your design. Last time when you built the first tank, you already laid all the pipes and you have reserved the space so you can build another tank. This is very intelligent. But as many members were saying, in fact, the planning department made public the data, and it is said that by 2026 there will be an increase of 57% in Tongchong's population, and these two reservoirs would not be adequate. Do you still have space reserved for a third service reservoir? And you don't have to lay pipes again, or by that time you will have to find another space and you will have to lay the pipes again.
Mr. Yang,
in fact, we have reserved space for future expansion of Tongchong. At the hilltop above the Soho 1 service reservoir, we have got space to expand our supply facilities. In fact, new roads would be built if the new town is expanded. We will lay pipes together with TDD when they build roads. So there will not be a big impact if we want to build a piping network. I still have some time. I'd like to follow up on what Dr. Helena Wong asked. Do we have better ways to work with other departments and hold joint meetings so you are assured that water will not be contaminated while the reservoirs can be opened up for the public to use? Do you have good proposals instead of just saying no? Let me explain a little. Actually, at the periphery of the reservoirs, Dr. Helena Wong was talking about the grassland, but on the side of the grassland, there are kiosks, which are for ventilation. If the public can enter the reservoir, contamination can happen through these kiosks. Organizations or departments who are interested can from time to time advise how the service reservoirs can be opened to the public, but we emphasize there must be a suitable management so the public will not contaminate the water. You can keep it simple, because more than one member is asking the question. You are just saying that you don't want to just open up the reservoir. You want to have group tours which are arranged to come along. Is that right? Very often for LCSD facilities, their facilities are managed. We need people to manage the reservoirs when the public come along to use the space so that water will not be contaminated. Mr. Yu, can members here to can members talk to LCSD? Well, actually, before you came in, they did not rule out the public's use of the reservoirs, and that is why I'm asking them to clarify that that is indeed their position. But if it is just open up and nobody manages the reservoirs, then they are worried. And I'm asking what we can do so that the reservoirs can be opened up to the public. Well, you can tell members what you plan to do, because at PWSC, they will be asking you the same question. Mr. Yu, do you support the funding request? Yes, I support it in principle. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Thank you, Chairman. Let you follow up on the public using the reservoir. I heard that you have an open mind, but you are worried that someone may inadvertently contaminate the water source. Let's ask about the design. You said that the water source could be contaminated. Is that going to be very easy, or do they have to access certain places? They have to open up a certain cover or something? I want to know whether your worry can be tackled. Is that a major worry, because people can come into contact with the source of water easily? And if that's the case, can we build some meshed wire or some hoarding, and you can set up a CCTV to monitor the situation? Mr. Yang, there is a chance of contamination, but our design would already minimize that opportunity. It is not easy, but if someone deliberately does it, he can succeed. If we hot up areas where contamination may take place, then a lot of the space would be kept away from the public. And it will not be an efficient way to manage the reservoir. Okay, if I only talk about the grassland, and I'm only talking about the grassland, will people be contaminating the water source? Will there be any openings of your pipes? Because this photo is taken from a slanted angle, I can't see it clearly. If I only refer to page 5, where there is grassland, a greening of the top side of the reservoir, will contamination be possible if people access that area? Well, if you look at this graph, if you see the black spots next to the on the periphery of the grassland, those are the kiosks that I talked about. And in fact, these kiosks are next to the grassland. Well, you can do something about the design, and I hope you will go back and talk to the LCSD. People who play soccer in Hong Kong will know that it is difficult to find a football pitch. I believe Tung Chung people would still like to use this area, even if it is a little remote. And in Hong Kong, you know, we have only one baseball court, and it is always fully booked. It is in Lam Tin. There is no hope of booking it. If you can open up this area, I'm sure people will be happy to take transportation to go there and play softball, cricket, baseball, and soccer, because we lack these venues. Another question. There is a road leading to it. How wide is that road? Is it for pedestrians or private cars? Is it dual carriageway or what? There is a road leading up to the present reservoir. It is from Wong Long Hang Road. It is a maintenance route. Design-wise, it is a little different from the normal road. It is not up to the same standard, because that road is only for our maintenance purpose. And the road will not be open to the public unless in emergencies. Okay, you can consider this with the LCSD. Mr. Tam, do you support this project? We do. Mr. Frankie Yick, does the LP support the funding request? BPA? Okay, that's it for this item. Apart from the Democratic Party, which has to wait for your supplementary information, you should explain that to the DP at PWSC. Members, now we go to item 8. We only have 15 minutes in our meeting.
On this Anderson Road Quarry site item, I think we can try what we can to see what we can do with the remaining time. But I think if there are fewer colleagues asking questions, maybe we can finish this item in, you know, 10, 15 minutes more. But let's see. This is PWP item number 765CL, development of Anderson Road Quarry site. Road improvement and infrastructure works. So, administration, please. We've got two papers, CP bracket 169I stroke 16-17 bracket 09 and bracket 10. One paper is provided by Secretariat. On this item, Mr. Wong Wai Man is with us. And Mr. Stephen Lee Tin Sang from CDD is also here. Will you take us through the paper? Please be precise. Chairman, briefly, on this project, PWP item number 765CL. Actually, we applied for funding last year, that is for the main works, and the main works has begun. So the remaining portion of the project is road improvement and infrastructure works. There are three projects involved. One is at the junction of Lin Tech Road and Summer Ping Road. There's a building to provide for pedestrian flyovers to reduce the necessity to bring in traffic lights. And second part of the improvement works are the junction of Clearwater Bay Road and Onsar Road, and also widening of a section of New Clearwater Bay Road near Shen Tin Chun Road. From Hiu Yuk Path to Hiu Ming Street, we'll construct an escalator link to improve accessibility. And the last part of the improvement works is in some green belts and recreation area in the quarry site. We'll carry out greening and landscaping works. We've consulted various district councils and won the support of two district councils. We hope that by April of 2017, we'll submit the proposal to the PWFC for funding. If everything goes smoothly, we hope that we can begin the works in early 2018 and have the works completed in phases from 2021 to 2023. So because this is a funding request, so members, please be reminded that according to Section 83A of the Rules of Procedures, members with direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please make a declaration before you speak. Three members have asked to speak. So, well, four together, who else likes to ask questions? Okay, I don't like to draw a line. I don't see much point in drawing a line. But I hope that after the four members have spoken, if possible, we can pass this proposal. Or if there are members coming in, then we will have to delay this project. Okay, Helena Wong, Zhuxing, Ho Kaming. Well, Ho Kaming first, 4 minutes, including question and answer. We do support this item. We do hope that the works can be completed as soon as possible because there are people living in the area already and it's too late. It's a little bit late to do the works in 2018 anyway. For Lin Tat Road works, it includes actually broadening the road by blasting part of the hill. So are you sure that the works can begin in 2018? And what about the technology use? Would the works create much noise nuisance? Because in less than 10 meters, there are residential dwellings. And also, the escalator link in Huming Path. We hope that the Innocent Road Quarry Bay can be linked to Somerping and then connected with Hill Yuk Path. But we found that there was supposed to be an escalator linking Chui Ping North Estate to Chui Ping Road, but because of objection from the owners and corporation, then you could not build that link. So, in other words, the escalator, when it goes to Huming Street, would not be connected with Hill Chui Ping Road, so people can only walk down the street. So, what do you think? Are you still planning to ask the PWC or Finance Committee, before you go to those committees, ask the owners and corporation to give you approval to build the necessary or missing link? Can you explain to us what your plans are, Mr. Wong? As for your first question on Lin Tat Road works, we will actually comply with all the environmental requirements and try to minimize the dust and noise pollution level. We also comply with requirements to have a district liaison group and maintain close contacts with nearby residents. If necessary, we can actually discuss issues through the liaison group. As for linkage, we actually had discussed the problem with necessary owners' corporation. We can go back to them again if they want to change their mind. Well, I think there are remaining portions of the works that can be dealt with separately, and we will see what happens and we'll try to maybe upgrade the project to grade A. How about the noise decibel involved? You think that you are in line with the environmental requirements, but if you have to blast open a hill, how much noise and dust pollution would that cause? And also, the owners and corporation is worried that if there are more people using the escalator, then there could be insurance issues. So would you try to sort out their concern about the insurance obligations so that they will let you build the escalator link? That is the necessary link from Anderson Road to Chui Ping Road. Mr. Lee, well, we want to reduce the nuisance to residents, so therefore we're using the mechanical approach. We won't have open blasts, and we will try to have facilities to prevent any dust pollution. We will follow what is required by law, and so the noise level will be below 10. And as for the Chui Ping road linkage, besides insurance, I think management and the possible nuisance to residents are the grounds for their concern. But I think, as Mr. Wong said, we will try to change the owner's corporation's mind and then try to incorporate the escalator project later on into the existing works. Next one, Mr. Oh Chong Shing. On the development of Anderson Road, whether at the district level or not, we have expressed a concern about transportation. In the future, when there will be 23 blocks to be built there and with an additional population of 48,000 people living there, I think the proposal now cannot resolve the future congestion, traffic congestion in the area. So I think the administration has to consider whether there needs to be a main flyover or elevated roads to be built in Anderson Road so as to ease the traffic congestion. Because with just minor traffic improvement works, you cannot resolve the expected congestion. Now, even now, without in the non-peak hours, there's congestion already, even before the new residential buildings are completed. So you need to consider how to resolve future congestion problem. Also in the paper, there's the mention of the building of a 170 meter long two-way escalator link between Hill York Path and Hill Ming Street. I think district council is mentioned that other districts have talked about building similar links. So how come you're only building this section of the escalator link? And also nearby Zhou Ping South Estate and the remaining pedestrian walkways, the timetable for building those links are pending nearby negotiations with other parties. So is it because of link rate that is it because of that that the timetable has not been confirmed? Well, at the last funding request, we received funding for four sets of escalator links. The remaining four sets of escalator links, as I mentioned, will actually depend on the future progress of the works, because there are legal issues related to resumption of land. So we are still working on the details. We need to deal with lawyers and talk to lawyers about the land issues. Therefore, we cannot commit at this stage on the building of the remaining links. Follow-up questions. At the district council, there are discussions, proposals for link between Summerpeng South Estate and another spot, and also Polam Road and other estate. So all those links are not included in your current works. Why? Mr. Wong, as explained in our paper, we will leave these links to the next stage of works after we have settled the legal problems. Chairman, on the transportation issue, how can you expect the minor traffic improvement works to ease congestion, heavy congestion that in the whole of Kun Tong, we know that improvement works have been undertaken over time? Under the Urban Renewal Authorities, Hip Wall Street project, the junction there, the traffic junction there will be improved. And we have come up with some traffic improvement measures. Chairman, because of time, may I ask the administration to give me a written reply on how to ease traffic congestion? I also like to move a motion later on. I've prepared a motion already. Yes, please submit it to us. Well, we'll adjourn this meeting early if that's the case. Because if I can't deal with this item by 5:35, I will leave it to the next meeting. But please give me the motion earlier, because I need to give members time to discuss the motion. So if you have a motion, you wouldn't say whether DAP will support this item, right? Yes. Yes. Okay, next one, Helena Wong, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I'm more concerned with the development density and the housing combination. This paper doesn't address the point about number of blocks we built and the rest population expected. Have you got the the plot ratio, the number of blocks to be built, development density. Have you got all those information with you already, Mr. Wong? Thank you, Chairman. For this entire works, well, it has got the approval of the Town Planning Board for the site formation for the main works. They got the funding approval in June last year in FC, in the FC. So for this particular paper, we only talk about the road improvement and infrastructure works. Mr. Lee, the planning department, with the approved plan by plan approved by the Town Planning Board, there are 11 residential sites. The plot ratio is about 3 to 5.5 plot ratio. There's a subsidized housing which has a plot ratio of up to 6.3. Helena Wong, Chairman, paragraph 18, where it talks about the building combination, it says that 80% of the quarry site will be built for private housing and 20% will be for subsidized housing, and it's only home ownership scheme flats, not public rental housing, right? Yes, that's correct. Because for the entire Anderson Road site, it's got two parts. The first part is near Anderson Village. There will be 48,000 units of subsidized housing. Above it will be 25,000 private units, of which 80% will be private units. So how many home ownership scheme flats will be built there, Mr. Wong or Mr. Lee? I think 1,700 out of the 5,000, for 5,000 people, have a private housing. There will be about 20,000 people living in the private housing. So 5,000 people in home ownership scheme flats and 20,000 people in private housing. So how? So why can't you add more public rental housing flats there instead of focusing so much on private and home ownership scheme flats? Because we have such a long queue waiting for public housing now.
Mr. Wong, I think we answered that question last year. There are two parts in this development. The first part is totally PRH at Ontart Estate for 48,000 people. In the entire Anderson site, 70% will be for public housing and subsidized public housing, and 30% for private development. We think that proportion is appropriate. I'd like to ask about the theme park. Will it reflect the history of the quarry site? Mr. Wong. Indeed, the park will seek to showcase the history of the site, but this project does not include the cost of that park. That will be taken up by the LCSD later. Why do you want to separate the two? Can you not talk to the LCSD? Before you come to PWSC, the LCSD has to tell us the concept of the park and also the timetable, or else everything will be so segregated. I think you can reply us in writing. We have overrun too much. I will leave this item to next month. Those members who have raised their hands are Jeremy Tam and Edward Yu. They will speak first at the next meeting, and we have a motion to process. If there is nothing under AOB, the meeting is adjourned.